Theo has decided to join us as well. There's something on the other side of the room that has really captivated his attention. Theo is gone, but someone else has entered the chat. I'm very, very pleased to say that we're joined by the wonderful, irreplaceable Josh Carr of the Who Knew podcast. How are you doing, Josh?
I'm very good. That's a hell of an intro. Thank you.
Touch me. High expectations, so you better not let everyone down.
Oh, I hope I don't. I really hope I don't. I'm sorry if I do.
But for those in the chat who are not aware of you, I don't know who wouldn't be, but just in case, can you please introduce yourself?
I am Josh Carr. I host a podcast called Who Knew, a Doctor Who podcast, where I sit down and chat with wonderful people from in and around the world of Doctor Who about their love for the show. And I've been lucky enough to have some people who work on the show as well involved. But that's mainly what I've been up to recently. So.
Yeah, brilliant. I also, while I remember, Josh was a massive help in putting together the 1963 charity stream from a couple of weeks ago. So I just want to take this opportunity to thank you from the bottom of my cholesterol-ridden heart for helping to put that together.
Thank you. Thank you for asking me to be involved. And congratulations, because you absolutely smashed it. Like, it's a ridiculous amount of money. But like I said, fair play. You've absolutely smashed it. And it was what I've seen of it so far. I haven't managed to catch up on all 12 hours yet, unfortunately. But what I've seen was absolutely fantastic. So
Brilliant. Thank you so much. So let's see if the finale of Doctor Who Flux smashed it.
Doctor Who Flush.
Did it flush its chances of being a good story? Nah, I can't salvage that. No, cut it. We'll cut the segment. We'll start again. Start from
that's
scratch.
That's like one of my segues.
That's a compliment coming from you. You've got the best segues and the best segments. I think you do.
Oh, thank you.
Even if it's just me. Anyway, so you've been doing weekly podcasts with guests about Doctor Who Flux, Flux, mm-hmm. which I haven't listened to because I knew that this live stream was coming and I wanted to get your opinion fresh from yourself. So I don't know what your thoughts have been generally on Doctor Who Flux.
Okay.
If you could briefly sum up, because I know that there are like six episodes of your podcast.
Yeah. I could definitely sum it up for you. I really like it. I really do. Overall, I think I have my issues with it, and I think there is a lot of potential in there that isn't necessarily wasted. It's just it could have been explored more had the circumstances around the creation of the series been a little bit more normal. As people who have listened will know, I've sort of been in from the very beginning, just pure chaos and excitement. And it's exactly what I watched Doctor Who for, really, just an absolute mad adventure. Like I said, there's a couple of episodes that was a little bit more lukewarm on, Survivors of the Flux. I liked it. I enjoyed it while I was watching it. Didn't hold up as well on a rewatch. Once Upon Time, I quite like, and same with Halloween Apocalypse. But I mean, the two standouts for me, Time of the Angels, and in particular, War of the Sontarans, which hands down my favourite so far.
Yeah, I think we're kind of on a similar wavelength, especially with the favourites being War of the Sontarans and A Village of the Angels. But because we had the finale, the Vanquishers, the Piper had to be paid. They couldn't just have standalone stories anymore. It had to actually tie in with everything that's been going on. So what did you think of the Vanquishers then? I know that's a very loaded question because it's a lot in an episode, isn't it?
Yeah. I've watched it twice now. First watch, I sort of just let it wash over me. And I had a really good time. I had a really, really good time. Again, I have my issues with it, but that my bar for Doctor Who episodes, I'm not going to lie to you, it's pretty low. If I have a fun time, I'm happy, to be honest. And then on a second watch, I think I liked it even more. I wasn't really expecting it to. I thought this is the kind of episode that would usually fall apart a little bit on a rewatch, but watched it again and just everything that I liked even more. And I thought it was, I think it had a really difficult job. And I think Chibnall backed himself into a bit of a corner with this finale. So the fact that, I think the fact that it's coherent with the amount of things he had to resolve is even a, you know, a triumph in itself. But I really enjoyed it. I really, really liked it.
Yeah, I think I had fun with it on my first viewing, but I kind of knew deep down there's a lot of issues. There's a lot I'm going to have to talk about here. But then on a second viewing, those issues did become more prominent, but the stuff I liked also seeped its way through as well. Like it's a story that kept on giving, really, in both respects. Because there's a lot going on, and things like Kate Stewart, like she had nothing to do. She really had nothing to do in this story, which is a shame.
One of my main gripes, if I'm honest, is the sidelining of Kate Stewart, I just think she made such a big impact in that the short time that she had in Survivors of the Flux, and I thought some of her moments were easily the best moments of the episode, and it all just got dropped. And I get that there was other things to focus on, but again, that's where what I was saying before comes in with you know the fact that this is a 6-episode series. I think you can tell there is a much, much bigger story and a much more expanded upon story to be told here. And it, for me, I think if we were looking at this as an 8 or a 9-episode series, we might, I'd probably have it definitely within my top 3, possibly top 2 series of all time. I think it would have been astounding, but I think because of how much was crammed into a short amount of time, a lot of things had to get dropped, and a lot of things didn't get developed as well as I would have liked, and some things got developed a little bit more than I would have liked as well. I think it worked on both sort of ends of the spectrum, but he's spinning plates making this, and he's also spinning a pandemic at the same time, so I think it's a cracking series. It is still really, really good.
I think the director Azur Salim, he had his work cut out for him this series with so many like competing storylines and multiple doctors and all the villains and everything. But now, like, looking at his body of work and everything that he's done as well for this episode, I think he was the perfect pick for it. Like, able to at least like visually and coherently transition between all of these plot threads, even if like what's on the page wasn't quite utilizing its potential. I think as a package, as like a piece of TV production, I think the series as a whole has been firing on all cylinders for the past 6 episodes. Like, I feel like it's kind of redundant at this point, but Doctor Who has never looked better. It feels like we say that almost every season. But I think with Flux, it's absolutely justified. Like, even though I can't say I was like emotionally involved, even like when the ships were getting destroyed at the end with the Cybermen, Daleks, Sontarans and everything, I got goosebumps sometimes because some of the great like productions and like the music and the score, it all came together, I think, in a production sense. And even moments where, like, I think the Lupari getting killed off should have been on screen or alluded to way more than it was. I was kind of expecting someone to say, like, "You're bluffing," and then like a dog corpse to like float across the window or something. It might have been a bit dark, but I kind of expected some reinforcement.
I mean, we got that in series 2. Like, we got stuff like that. We've seen stuff like that before in Doctor Who. I think that worked.
But I think what sold it was Craig L's like reaction, that like quiet fury in that bubble. And he's like caked in like a dog makeup. And, like, I did not want to be in front of him when he exploded. I think he and the cast, like, managed to sell the emotional stakes, even if it wasn't fully on the page, I think. The cast is great.
Yeah, the cast is incredible. And, like I said, I completely agree with what you said about it's never looked better, Doctor Who. Because at the minute, people who follow me on Twitter might have seen that I'm doing a big rewatch of all of New Who. and I've been collating all my thoughts on a thread, and it's sort of fallen quite nicely in line. I mean, it's quite a weird comparison, but I watched on the same day Jodie's fourth to last episode and her fourth episode. I watched Arachnids in the UK like straight after the Vanquishers. And I mean, I thought series 11 looked great. I have criticisms of series 11, but it looks fantastic. Mm. And this is like 10 levels above that. I think this looked like a Star Wars film to me. I think it looked like a big budget blockbuster. And again, like you said, the cast as well make it, because when you've got an ensemble like that of like the best of British TV actors that are out there, you know, you're like cherry picking from the best dramas from across the BBC and ITV and Channel 4 and things like that. You're always going to strike gold, you know. Like, I think you've mentioned Craig Parkinson a lot, and great casting. Slightly disappointed with the character, and it's one that I feel a lot of the things that I feel a little bit disappointed by are actually the things that I'm looking at and thinking, this is what could come back in the next three episodes, mainly the centenary. I think, you know, the threads that I didn't find as satisfying, like the Grand Serpent, Bell and Vinda, they ended neatly, but I just felt like it needed a little bit more. But I think I could see them coming back over the next few episodes, and I would welcome that with open arms as well, because as you said, this cast is unreal.
Yeah, I said in my review of Once Upon Time that this felt like a pandemic production, in the sense, like, the subtext and the story of, like, Bell and Vinda, like, trying to navigate and find each other at, like, after separation at the end of the world, basically. So when they did reunite in this story, and they hug in the TARDIS, and Dan and Di hug in the TARDIS as well, I'm not gonna lie, I got a little lump in my throat. Like, that's just
I
me.
Did too. But no, it was nice. It was a lovely little moment.
Yeah, and I think Thaddea Graham has been like the breakout star, like casting wise of this season. I think she's been terrific, and I'm very glad that little bubby that was on the screen on her arm did not turn out to be something vital. It wasn't like, oh, I'm a loom. I'm the son of Long Barrow. it was just a bubby, which I'm kind of very happy with, but it kind of shows how on edge the fandom might be, that they expected that, oh, it's the Doctor or so. Yeah, I think there's a discrepancy between the fandom and the show itself sometimes, but I'm glad that didn't happen.
Yeah, I sort of am too. I think it was nice to have that thread in there of just normal people, and because, like, as you said, like the pandemic production side, I think in the past two episodes has definitely sort of come to a head as well. Obviously, I sort of got it about the same time as you with the whole Bell and Vinda introduction, but it's nice to just track how normal people are affected through the effects of big things in the Doctor Who universe. Like Rusty Davies used to do it, obviously in a more subdued way, like sort of just the odd little scene here and there where we see normal people just dealing with these things. But to have it as a through line through the series, I thought it did work really, really well. Mm. I just want to see more of them. I think it's not that I wasn't satisfied with their ending. I just want more. Mm. And I sort of feel like that about a lot of this, because I love so many of the individual threads of it. I'm satisfied with. I just want more because I love it.
Yeah, I think some of the characters and like the roles they had that paid off in this episode were really oddly placed. Like, I think it's strange that Carr Vanista didn't get like the Sontaran showdown at the end. It was Jericho who made the proclamation, which is a bit strange. And also Vinda was the whistleblower of the Grand Serpent, but it turns out Kate Stewart is the epic rival that he'll track down through Hell and High Water. Like, I feel like Vinda should have been maybe the one who the Grand Serpent was chasing, maybe because of his confession and everything earlier on, and got sent to Outpost Rose, maybe he brought the Grand Serpent down or something. But yeah, it felt really odd, though. I don't know if I'm alone in that, though.
There are a few bits where I think you could swap a few moments around for people. Like you said about Jericho, I thought the perfect tie-up for him would be if Carvanista sort of took the role of, like, as you said, like the big speech against the Sontarans, and Jericho, you know, died. Maybe there were a few of the human test subjects that the Sontarans had taken left on the ships or something, and Jericho saved them. He gave up his transport ring to save them. I thought that would have been really nice, especially with the fact that they're the kind of people that he works on and he's now liberating them. Something like that would have been a bit nicer. And then Carvanista gets his big moment. I also feel like this episode was lacking, and there was a moment where Dan frees Carvanista, and then we just cut to Carvanista and Dan with everyone else in the TARDIS. I thought there was a lovely little moment there where you could have had Dan and Carvanista connecting.
Yeah,
obviously as sort of frenemies, where they don't really like each other, but you know, Dan reaches out and we see Dan's kindness again and how much he can help people when Carvanista's in like his darkest day. I feel like a lovely little moment like that. And again, that's where a bit more room to breathe. You know, if this was a two-part finale, or if we'd had an hour and a half, I think it could have been really, really great. I liked it a lot, but a few moments like that could have really been fleshed out and just made the emotional moments hit a bit harder as well.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that point with Dan and Carvanista. Like, because Dan goes into that prison, like, making jokes and stuff, and presumably not knowing what has happened to the Lupari. And then Carvanista, like, shoves past him. And then it cuts to him being Solemn in the TARDIS, and Dan is now telling other people that the Lupari have been wiped out.
Yeah.
It seems like...
It happened off screen.
Yeah, so. But the line that he does say in that scene when breaking out him out of the prison was, oh, I guess that hermit knew what he was on about, or words to that effect. When it kind of shows that the priorities aren't quite aligning. They prioritized that gag and that callback as opposed to an actual character defining or a character culmination moment. And then the next time they interact is when Di hugs Dan in the TARDIS and they say, oh, I wasn't late. It would blame that guy. And just there's the dog man there. The priorities are really, really strange, especially like with how Di and Passenger somehow knows everything about how Passenger works, even though Vinder's had the training on how to escape Passenger. And I think Chibnall just likes the frenetic pace and the moving back and forth, regardless of the consequences inadvertently to the characters.
And I mean, I think there's benefits to that. Like I said, I mean, the pacing, I mean, it doesn't really let up. So I sort of didn't really get a chance to think about it while I was watching it. It was sort of afterwards when all of these things start popping into your head, which makes it just an enjoyable watch while you're in it. I do like that everybody had a bit of agency and everyone did get, even if it was a tiny moment, they did do everything they could to give everyone a moment to shine. And give everyone like a little bit of time in the spotlight. I quite liked the fact that, you know, we don't really know how long from Di's perspective she's been in there. I mean, is it explained that it's the same amount of time that Dan's been with the Doctor, or could that be the reason why Di's a little bit more off with Dan? Like, for Dan, it's only been, technically the whole series has been like a couple of days to him. But could this have felt so much longer for Di, and that's why she's been able to figure all of this stuff out? She's been in there for so much longer. And that's why she's got that bit of agency. I don't know. I quite liked it, but it sort of hinges on, again, like headcanon and things like that. I like to think she was in there for months from her perspective, and it was a lot harder for her than Dan maybe realizes.
Yeah, I think that 3-year time jump for survivors of the Flux as well kind of skews everything as well. And
it does,
it feels like it's a time jump that has only happened to 3 of the characters. So it's the characters aren't even like aligned properly in terms of chronology, which I didn't think of it that way. But let's also briefly touch upon Swarm and Azure as well. It was their last appearance. Time turned up at the end to be the big bad, I think. I don't know. And dusted them away. What did you think of that conclusion?
I think I'm in the camp at the moment, which I haven't seen many people say, of I don't think we're done with Swarm and Azure. I think we will see them again before the end of 13's era. I've just got a feeling they could pop up in the centenary, and I think they're going to go a bit balls to the wall in the centenary and chuck everything out. Swarm, Azure, Master, Time's Child stuff. So the resolution is a bit weak, but part of me thinking, is it weak because they're coming back? Or is it, I mean, if this is the last time we see them, I am pretty lukewarm on it. And I'm sort of lukewarm on them in the back half of the series. I think they started so well and I loved them and I just wanted to see more. It's that thing again. I just liked them so much. I wanted to see more, and I did feel like they got sidelined a bit. There was a bit of Spider-Man 3, effect with this series, with a lot of villains crammed in to a short amount of time, so that they couldn't really get to show a big bad.
Yeah.
I mean, I like the whole concept of like time personified as like a manifesting being. It's really weird, sort of high concept sci-fi that I'm here for in Doctor Who. I don't really understand it, but why not? I know a lot of people have been a bit iffy on the whole foreseeing the death of the Doctor in a very similar way to the Ood did. But I like that moment. I think it sets up the next 3 specials very nicely. Swarm and Azure, I really like them, and I like them as villains. And I think we have to see them again in order for me to get on board with the way that they left.
Yeah. Can I also get a quick thumbs up or thumbs down? Santarin's eating chocolate. For me, it's a big thumbs up. I found that scene very funny.
I'll build up.
Yeah.
It is the biggest thumbs up on planet Earth and planet Santar for me. It was genuinely, I don't think I've laughed at a moment of Doctor Who like that before. I was curled up cackling like a little witch. I just thought it was brilliant.
I
think the Santarans in this series, both War of the Santarans, which again is my favorite episode of the series, definitely a standout for me, and in this, I just thought they were the best characterization we've seen. That's what I said on the podcast. And with this episode furthered that even more for me. I just think they've taken everything that we knew about the Santarans on a base level, and they've just elevated it. And they've given us that hilarious parody of imperialism and just someone who can be a genuine threat 1 second and have you howling in laughter the next is such a brilliant thing to have in Who. And it's sort of the only thing that you only place you could have it. It's sort of they just work in this era.
Yeah, because I watched the finale with Yaz, and she's only watched like 3 episodes of this season. She's been dipping in and out, and I think she was really enjoying the finale, even if I don't think like either of us could follow it properly, really. But I think because it was able to be so funny frequently, and the production values are really high, and it moves really quickly, I think it stands up on a first viewing just through sheer force of will. Whether or not it will on repeat viewings and scrutiny will of course remain to be seen. But speaking of like Sontarans and great villain characterization, I love how Chibnall characterizes the Daleks, and they're coming back for the New Year's Day special.
Yes,
we've got that for a transition.
Very good.
There we go.
And even, very good.
And even Theo is here to voice his approval. So Eve of the Daleks is going to be dropping on New Year's Day. We don't have confirmed writer or director, but we can presume Chris Chibnall was probably penning it in Elf storage facility. What did you make of that trailer and the reveal of the information we got?
I thought the full trailer that dropped on Twitter is one of the best trailers we've got for a Doctor Who episode for ages. I'm really, really excited for it. I think... Well, someone mentioned to me, I tweeted saying, like, Doctor Who has been crying out for a Groundhog Day episode for decades. They should, this could have happened years and years ago. I think this era is a great time to do it, because I got crucified on Twitter for saying it, but I think Chibnall's humour just really lands with me. And I think this could be a really fun... But there's quite a few horror elements in the trailer as well, which I'm excited to see pay off. But yeah, I'm excited to see the time loop element, because someone mentioned to me on Twitter, like, the closest we've got is Heaven Sent, but, you know, I don't think anyone would call Heaven Sent like a comedic masterpiece. Heaven Sent sort of just in and of its own a different thing, which is magnificent. But this sort of gets to play with the time loop idea a bit more, in a bit more of a fun way, which I'm really excited for. And Daleks on New Year's Day. I'm going to be hungover, full of food, probably sat with a pizza in my pajamas. And all I want is shouty boys, these boys here. That's all I want. I just want shouty boys. I want shouty boy action. That's exactly what I want on New Year's Day.
Yeah, because it's from, of course, the production block after Doctor Who Flux, so it's still done with restrictions, it's still done with, like, bubbles and everything. So when I saw the trailer, it just really made sense to me. Like, film it predominantly in a warehouse, or in this storage facility, limited cast, but it's Daleks, and you repeat the sets, you repeat the set pieces, maybe with a Groundhog Day scenario. It seems so clever, but also really inspired and, like, justifying of a special. I think, yeah, it could, of course, completely flop or whatever, but I think that the elements are there for something really special this New Year's.
Yeah.
And also, like I said, I just really enjoy how Chibnall has characterized the Daleks as well. I'm curious as to whether or not, if it's an hour-long special, like half an hour in, they'll drop everything and move on to something else. Maybe the master box props man will turn out to be the real villain of that storage facility.
I think, as I've alluded to, I think there's a lot of things in flux. A lot of people have been talking on Twitter that I have to mention.
Oh yeah, I don't recommend it.
Yeah. But the universe is still like 99% dead, which is not mentioned really in any way, and not really resolved. I can't see a world where Chibnall has just completely ignored that. I think whether that's going to be resolved at some point in the next 3 episodes, surely.
I think it could be for me to think that the universe is dead.
Yeah, I was like, I just think that, like I said, there's so many things that are left open. Obviously, the whole timeless child stuff, the universe being half dead. I don't think these specials are going to be as standalone as they're making out. I think Eve of the Daleks is sort of going to act as a prologue, like an epilogue. I mean, not prologue, that's the other one. It's sort of going to act as an epilogue, and it's going to resolve a few things, and then a few things are still going to carry over into the Easter, and then that might resolve a couple of things, and then we get the big bonanza.
Yeah, and yeah, I think I'll be the same as you as well, hungover. I'll probably be under like the same blanket as you as well, with the same pizza. Enjoy.
What, just on my sofa? We're just going to snuggle up together.
Yeah, or maybe the world's longest blanket.
You're more than welcome. Come round, mate. I'll have you all round. there's 170 of you watching. That's scary.
It better be a big blanket.
Yep. Big old blanket. There's a big blanket at Who Knew HQ waiting for all of you to snuggle up under.
Except Daniel in the chat. Daniel's not invited. Anyway.
Daniel, calm down, mate. Have a nice calm tea.
Have a Snickers.
It's fine. It's okay. It's all right. Everything's okay.
Exactly. And Josh is one of the most laid back guys as well, with the most laid back of podcasts. How can people find said podcast for laid back Josh Antos?
Yes. People can find the podcast on YouTube. If you type in Who Knew a Doctor Who podcast, I'm sure it'll pop up. I hope it does. If not, tell me what does. You can find it on Spotify. You can find it wherever you get your podcasts, really. You can find us on Twitter at Who Knew Podcast. In terms of what's coming up, I've got the final episode of Who Knew Fluxed. I've had a different guest on each week. As you said, Adam Martin was on last week. We've had George Sheard for the 800th time, TARDIS Monkey, Chloe Lily off Twitter, the meme queen, and Dominic G. Martin. And then I've got Beth Axford on to speak to me about the Vanquishers. And then next week, I somehow have an episode coming out with Pete Levy, the producer of Once Upon Time, Survivors of the Flux, and the Vanquishers, to sort of act as an epilogue to Who Knew Fluxed. And we'll chat about the behind the scenes and what it was like making this mental series during COVID. So, that's where you can find me.
Yeah, wonderful stuff. Folks, there are links to the Who Knew Twitter and Josh's Twitter as well in the video description below, so you can find them, shortcuts to everything there. Thank you so much for joining us, Josh, and I'll let you get to the rest of your evening. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. I'm probably just going to tune back in, so I might hang around the live chat for a bit and say hello. But yeah, thank you for having me on. Absolutely loved it.
And the chat...
There's no such thing as macro, obviously.
Exactly, especially not tonight. I've got the cyber controller mug, so no macro tonight. No such thing. Josh, thank you so much. The chat as well as sharing their love for you as well. Thank you so much.
Love you guys. See ya. Thank you.
Bye.
Now,
that might have been the first time that I've properly spoken to Josh on this stream where there haven't been technical issues. So I'm very, very happy. Very, very happy about that. There are links to Josh's Twitter, the Who Knew Podcast Twitter, in the description below. Check it all out. Daniel Stevens in the chat, you think you're so funny, aren't you? Do you know what is funny, Daniel? Dr. Karen. That's very, very funny. And you know what you do when you have a funny joke? Repeat it over and over again. Just Dr. Karen, every comment, repeat it over and over again. Because that means you've got a good joke if you have to repeat it and repeat it and repeat it and repeat it. Yep, ironclad.